Listening Library presents 1, 2, 3 Scream by R.U. Ginns. Read for you by Kathleen McInerney. With a prologue and epilogue read by the author. This book is dedicated to anyone reckless enough to read it. R.U. Ginns.
Four words. Everywhere I go, people ask me, "Are you Ginns?" I have to admit, it's a very good question. Almost always, my answer is yes. I am Are You Ginns, the author of these stories. I am the person who day after day, night after night, tapped with one finger at my keyboard to create the words you are now hearing. I usually use my index finger. I raise it high above my head and bring it down with 3 or 4 quick taps in a row. Then I stop and I look around. It's important to know if anyone or anything is watching. People, librarians, birds. When I'm writing in a coffee shop or in a bus station or on the floor in the potato chip aisle at a grocery store, my tap-tap-tapping is enough to scare away most people. Sometimes when I'm writing in a library, librarians come over and ask me to type a little quieter, please. I don't like it when people tell me which words I should type. A, little, quieter, and please are 4 perfectly good words, but I shouldn't have to stop writing my words and switch to typing something else just because someone asked me to, even if one of those words is please. I must keep writing my stories. I cannot stop. So, instead of answering them, I give those librarians my super evil glare. I frown. Then I slowly raise one eyebrow and I look into their eyes for a long time without blinking. This is the best way to let everyone know that I must keep writing. When librarians see a super evil glare, they usually stop asking authors to type, "A little quieter, please." They almost never ask me what I'm writing. And they never, ever ask me to consider leaving because it's midnight and the library closed many hours ago. I only wish my super evil glare worked on birds. But no, it doesn't. Nothing is powerful enough to scare away crows, or finches, or pelicans. That is why you should think twice before you go outside. So yes, I am the person who typed every letter of every word of every sentence in this book. I tapped and tapped, and when my fingers began to hurt too much, I finished the last story by typing with my elbows. Do you know how hard it is to type a whole story with just elbows? Can you imagine how many times I had to go back and fix all the mistakes? When you type with elbows, it can take a half hour just to type 4 words. Now I am tired. No 4 words have ever been more true. I have typed and tapped and elbowed 100,946 letters, and I am exhausted. I am so very tired, and yet I am not able to sleep. How could anyone sleep after writing these stories? How could anyone sleep after learning what I have learned? Every now and then, when I'm not writing, I have to leave my heavily reinforced and booby-trapped living space for some reason, like to go shopping. I drink a lot of lemon tea, and I'm a big fan of saltwater taffy, so my supplies run out often. It was during these expeditions when I learned about all the people and events in this terrible collection. And there is no doubt in my mind. Everything in this book is true. 100% true. That's why I had to write it all down. I've changed most of the names in these stories for your safety. But don't feel too safe. I know I don't. Now you are in on the secret. I hope my book brings you hours of fun and guidance. Guidance that might help you avoid the fates that befall the poor subjects of these tales. I hope you find the stories hilarifying. I hope you are able to sleep after listening to them. Or not. And now that you have heard my foreword, you are ready to hear another four words. 1, 2, 3, scream.
Instagrave. Here lies the body of Isabel Jones. They found all her skin, but none of her bones. Wait, what? Asked Monica Green's friend, Isabel. She was staring at her phone with a perplexed look on her face. She showed her phone to Monica as they stood in line for the school bus. It was open to an app called Instagrave. The picture of Isabel's future tombstone filled the screen.
Pretty strange, don't you think, Monica? She asked. How could I be found without my bones? Where did they go? What's going to kill me?
Monica looked at the phone, then at her confused friend. As soon as Instagrave had first popped up mysteriously on someone's phone, it spread like wildfire. The whole school was obsessed with learning how they were going to die. But the answers didn't always make sense. Monica tried to come up with a few things that might result in the kind of death Instagrave described to Isabel.
A giant mosquito? Monica asked. It could suck out your insides. It would have to be pretty big, said Isabel. Otherwise, I don't think it would have enough suction. Wait, that doesn't answer the bone question. How about an accident with a fancy kitchen gadget?
Monica suggested.
Maybe, said Isabel, nodding. But I don't do a lot of cooking. Kitchen gadgets aren't really my thing.
Monica didn't want to spend any more time thinking about her friend's death. Her whole class would be on the bus soon, and she wanted to learn about her own death before they got to Red Ledge Canyon. She reached into her pocket for her phone.
Hey, everyone!
Solomon Roy shouted from three places ahead in the line.
I'm going to smash into the ground, see?
He held his phone over his head. Monica squinted at it along with everyone else. She saw an obelisk beside a crater. Words were carved into the narrow stone monument. This is the crash site of Solomon Roy. His emergency parachute failed to deploy. While a dozen kids gathered to peek at Solomon's memorial, Monica stood back. She unlocked her phone and launched Instagrave.
Get back in line, everyone, Ms. Walker ordered. I need a head count of all my fourth graders before we get on the bus.
As her teacher walked past, counting heads, Monica stared at her phone. A creepy skull filled the screen. Red lights flashed in its eye sockets, and the app crashed. The screen flickered bright blue for a moment, then faded to black. After a moment, the home screen reappeared. Monica groaned softly. Her phone had been giving her trouble all week. Someone tapped her on the shoulder. She turned to see Kayla Brown behind her with a big smile on her face. She held out her phone for Monica to see. On the screen, a selfie of Kayla wore the same happy expression.
Get ready, said Kayla. My face is about to rot. 1, 2, 3, 4.
As her friend counted, the smiling face began to shrivel. Monica watched as the skin puckered. It curdled like a bowl of butterscotch pudding left out in the sun for days, except that it happened really quickly, over the course of a few seconds. Kayla's face crumbled away, leaving nothing but a shiny white skull.
12, 13, go, said Kayla.
She pressed the lightning bolt button beneath the skull. Drops of blood trickled from the top of the screen, and a hammer and chisel appeared. The tools blinked and rocked.
Instagrave was calculating. A gray marble tombstone appeared. It had scuba goggles and a snorkel carved into the stone above chiseled words. Kayla wrinkled her nose as she read them out loud.
This grave is in memory of Kayla J. Brown. She thought she was rising while she swam straight down.
Hey, Kayla! Someone called from behind them in line. Isn't your family planning to visit relatives in Trinidad?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.